Doing in Glasgow, by the way.
Cum vrei?
Am uitat să întreb. Nu știu, am uitat să întreb. Am uitat să întreb. My bad. Hai să încercăm, nu știu, româna mea o să fie foarte proastă. Foarte proastă. Hai să încercăm și în română, să vedem cum iasă. N-am făcut niciodată română, hai să vedem cum iasă. Hai să îmi fac un screen share. Eu nu o să am, ca și în chestia asta, eu nu o să am chat. Dacă cineva are o întrebare, Ștefan, este legat să îmi spui întrebările.
Da, cum să nu?
Că, vorba aia, n-am știut că facem chestia asta în seara asta, n-au avut destul de advanced warning, cum aveau lună sau ceva și n-au vreme să-mi pun al doilea monitor pe masă. Nu. Băi, totally n-au avut destul de vreme. Bun, hai să vedem. Ok. Salut, eu sunt Alex și I do a bunch of things in this world, dar cred că ce e relevant în seara asta, technology lead la Intellegia Foundation, a different kind of thing, it's a non-profit, there's no money involved, so whatever I'm telling you here, I don't make money off of it, it's not even actually my tech. It's something I've been really interested in and somehow I ended up getting a job. Aparent, nu se poate în română. Aparent, nu se poate în română și facem în engleză. Am încercat.
Nu cred că se supără nimeni. E ok.
Well, I really, really tried. Okay, so the reason I'm talking about this is I tried to make money on the internet. I'm a web developer. I was a web developer for... Actually, yesterday was 11 years since I started my first job. So I've been a web developer for 11 years, and I wanted to make money on the internet with my work. And everybody said ads. Ads are the way you make money with the website. Ads are easy to install. And it's okay. If as soon as I moved here, ads were actually easier to install on the website. Back to Romania, because we're not one of those countries where everybody thinks, oh, they should work there. Ads weren't that easy to work with. In here, easier to work with. But what happens when I put ads on my website? They show up everywhere. I mean, the content relative to the ads is half and half. People kind of go off just because there's so many ads on a web page, right? And in order to make some real money with your website by doing ads, you have to have a lot of ads because you get paid more when people click on it. You have to kind of track people, and there's an overload of ads. If you try to I think I went on Stille Proste there the other day, and it took a full 2 minutes until all the ads loaded. The content was there after in a few seconds, but while all the video ads loaded and then they swapped them up, it took a really long time to load just because of that. The other problem with ads or putting ads on your website is most people like you and me, we run an ad blocker. Hell, we run more than one ad blocker. I actually have two, one on my network, and then one on my browser. So the ads that really managed to make it past two ad blockers, that's not a lot. And most of the addressable market for a developer as a developer runs an ad blocker because it's popular. So making money with ads turns out it's really problematic unless you're running a huge website. So to give you a bit of context, my personal website has probably 10,000 visitors a month if I'm lucky. If I'm really lucky, I get 10,000 visitors a month. If I'm unlucky, I get 100,000. And to put ads on it, I would get probably a few dollars a month from ads. A few dollars a month from ads, not really doable. Some of the other websites on the internet have a million views a month. Yeah, they do okay from ads. I think the running rate, Google has a little calculator for ads. If you make 400,000 views a day, you actually make around 10 grand from ads. But that's 400,000 views a day to make money from ads, right? It doesn't really scale down to people like me who don't have a huge presence. So I looked at other things to make money on the internet. And last year, I found this thing called the Web Monetization API. And it's a web API. It's a standard that's being incubated at the W3C right now. So it's baked into the web somehow. And the Web Monetization API works on a simple concept, a meta tag. You put a meta tag on your website, and congratulations, your website makes money whenever somebody visits the page. with a certain type of content. So I have that in my, on my page. The content part is the wallet part. The content is basically telling the website what my address on the internet is so they can deposit the money in that account. Now, I'm actually going to show you how it looks like on my website. Let me open up. You can probably see. So let me share my website. So I go on. I go on my website and view source. No, that's just not good. This is it. Meta name monetization, and then the content is my wallet address. There's a bunch of, it sounds easy, you only put this thing on your website and you start getting money. Here's where all the catches start to come in. Because it's a new technology, the browsers haven't implemented it yet. So to make this work, you have to get an extension which basically pays on your behalf. So I don't get money from all the people who visit my website. I get money from the people who have this little extension installed. And that's where my money comes from. The extension or the provider right now, because it's an experimental API, there's only one provider right now, which is kind of shitty because it doesn't give you a lot of choice. I mean, $5, me as an individual pay $5 a month to kind of give money away so I don't get tracked by ads to my favorite creators. Some other parts of the world, $5 is a bit much and there's not an alternative for them. Some parts of the world, $5 is a bit, it's not a lot of money, and then you're looking for alternatives. So I have this little add-on installed from Coil that actually goes on every web page I visit, looks for this little meta tag, and if it sees the meta tag, it starts paying that website for the time I spend on page. So the rate is 56 cents an hour. You can see why I'm doing all my demos on my website, right? Technically, while I'm doing this, I am paying myself. But the rate is 36 cents an hour. So anyone who has the Coil extension and visits my page, send me money every second. And if you add up the entire hour, it adds up to 36 cents. Now, Coil also has this little thing that's enabled just for selected people, where people can send me a tip for my content. They like what I did with my article. They can send me a dollar as a thank you. I got some of those as well. Now for the other part, so if you have a Coil extension and if you had that little meta tag, technically to make money, I only need the meta tag, right? If I have that on my website, anyone with the extension pays me. Now I'm a special case where I actually have the extension, so I pay other people as well. That's completely optional from the API point of view. The other piece missing in between them is I have a way to pay, I have somewhere to be paid. The somewhere to be paid part, there's a few options there as well. So webmonetization.org, you need a digital wallet of some sort because you can be paid directly into a bank account. You need some way to get money and then move that money to a bank account. There's two of those digital wallets right now in web monetization. One of them is called Uphold, which I'm using. The other one is GitHub. I feel like in Europe, Uphold is a little less popular and GitHub is a bit more popular. In Europe, in the US, Uphold is a bit more popular. And the only thing you need to open an account and start receiving money in one of those is an email address. So you sign up for an account and they give you that little string, that little content string to be able to get money. Actually, I can go into my account and see how that looks like. And you're going to see how much money I've made out of web monetization in an entire year. I think I put it on my website last year, in November, sometime around in November last year. And we'll get to see how much money I made in an entire year with this. So my Coil account, £14. That's actually not bad. So over the entire year, I made £14 out of this instead of having ads on my website. Because I have an account, I have this little string in here. That's my payment point. It's basically my address for my wallet. And then I give that to web installation, and then I start receiving money. And this is the easiest way to implement it, is that little meta tag. You sign up for a wallet here, you get that payment pointer, you put it into a meta tag on your website. Congratulations, you start making money. Now, what happens if I have a more complex use case and I want to receive money? Some use cases have to do with, I only want to show you a certain type of content if you pay me. For example, for mine, it's basically you're donating to my website. You don't get anything extra for having web monetization, for being web monetized. As there's some other people out there using web monetization, things like news agencies and stuff like that. If you try to watch the news on the New York Times, for example, they ask for money to be able to share an article. There's some people who use it for that. And if you want a more advanced use case, there's also a JavaScript API. Now, the JavaScript API allows you to figure out if people have started paying you, have stopped paying you, if they're still continuing to pay you. And you can do things with your content based on that JavaScript API. The reason I'm not going to talk a lot about this JavaScript API tonight is we're literally in the process of changing it. So I'm part of the editor team that works on the API at the W3C. And we're literally in the process of changing it. We're meeting up in San Francisco next week. No, the week after next. We're meeting up in San Francisco the week after next to finish up the new API. And the new API is going to look a bit different. There's not going to be any start or stop anymore. It's only going to be you've got the payment and you keep having to listen to for that those payment events to be able to show different content. And the other thing that's gonna change, and that is actually supported right now, we're converting the meta tag to a link tag because of the way the browsers deal internally with the link tag. So instead of being a meta tag, we're going to have a link tag. That's already baked into the extension, and it works today. If you want to give it a try, if you want to put web monetization on your website, you probably have to do both of those things to kind of be on the safe side. And it converts really easy. So whatever you get from Uphold with dollar ILP something something / random string, you change the dollar with an HTTPS, and that's basically the URL for your wallet. All of this is at the W3C, by the way. So if you want to check out some of the things we're talking about, if you have an idea where you think you could contribute, for example, we have a running conversation right now. So we have an HTML component and a JavaScript component. If you want to use the HTML component, it's literally a line of HTML, and you can put that on your website. But if you want to do something more complex, like hide and show content based on people paying you money or not, which is a valid use case for things like newsletters or whatever, you have to implement all that JavaScript API, or you have to work with JavaScript, and maybe developers are completely happy with that. But some of the people who are using this, they're not developers, or they're not JavaScript developers, so there's a middle ground here, an opportunity for a CSS type of API that goes with this. Something like a media query. We're actually having a conversation right now about the media query, where you can say if you're monetized, if the page is monetized, display this content or otherwise display none. So there's a lot of opportunities to participate. We're trying really hard to finish the standard this month at the end of the year. So then in the next year, we can move it and bake it into the browser. We've already got a few browsers who are really interested to see how this works natively instead of through the extension. And we're trying to go there. But if web monetization isn't your thing and ads aren't your thing, how else can you make money on the internet? And I immediately went sales, right? If I want to make money over the internet, I can just sell stuff on the internet. I could, if I was based in the UK like I am now, or if I was based in the US. Back home, the payment processors were a bit shifty in the sense that I had to give them quite a bit of money. Quite a bit of my sales to be able to process sales. If I wanted to go external to things like Stripe, for example, which is really popular, Slovenia wasn't supported in Stripe for a really long time, so I had no option. If I tried to use my bank account to get paid in my bank account, because we weren't accepting international payments for a really long time through ACH, international payments used to be a 72-hour process. So when you try to sell things on the internet, it becomes really complicated. You have a few options on how to move money from one end to the other, so how to make money appear in your account. One of them is PayPal. Now PayPal opened up its entirety of the features in Romania. When I left, I was getting money out of PayPal, and I had to go through, I had to show them my bills for like 2 months in a row to prove I was a real person and that I wasn't money laundering. So the whole process through PayPal was quite complicated. The US has something called Venmo. I don't know if we have that back home or something similar to that. There's also banks, right? And there's even Starbucks. You can hold money on your Starbucks account. So technically, you could use all of these to pay for things. The problem is they don't really talk to each other, or they don't really work with each other. So for example, I bank in here with Metro Bank. If I'm trying to send money to another Metro Bank account, it's easy and cheap. It's basically in the same bank. A zero moves in a database, and I send money from one account to the other. It happens instantly. I don't get charged for it, so it's easy and cheap. Because the money actually never leaves the bank. They leave my account, but they never leave the bank. If the money has to leave the bank, so for example, if I'm trying to send money across to the U.S., it's cheap because my banks and most of the U.S. banks have a working relationship, and I don't pay fees on it, but it stops being easy. I have to get an international bank account from the U.S., something that's IBAN or SWIFT or whatever. It doesn't really work with the same account type that I have when I send the money. If I'm trying to send money back home to my mom, to Banca Transilvania, it's not being easy and cheap because my little bank in the UK and Banca Transilvania actually don't have a working relationship. The money never goes from Metro Bank to Banca Transilvania. The money goes to a US bank, and from the US bank it goes to Banca Transilvania because I'm not gonna make a Brexit joke. I'm not gonna make a Brexit joke. Because we left the EU, technically our banks don't talk to each other anymore. So you have to go to a third party bank. Now, the problem with the third-party bank is it takes a while, up to 72 hours for the money to leave my bank and get to the intermediary bank, and it takes another up to 72 hours for the money to get back to Banca Transilvania. So depending on what route they take, sometimes my money gets to my mom's on the same day because they're using modern banks, and sometimes it takes a whole week for me to send money back home. So paying somebody the UK to Romania is not a long distance in banking. It's one of those corridors which could be easily fixed. If I'm trying to do the same thing to Nigeria, that's just out of this world complicated. If I wanted to send mom money out of my Starbucks account, that becomes impossible. So technically, there's a Starbucks Romania and there's a Starbucks UK. You can have a Starbucks card with both and you can hold money with both. You just can't move money between those because they're completely different systems that never talk to each other. So it becomes impossible. There's a different way to send money on the internet, and that's the thing that underpins the web monetization protocol. And this is the little bit of tech where I'm working on, and it's called Interledger. And it's a protocol, so basically a bunch of words on a piece of paper that were designed to create a network that lets banks or ledgers of any kind talk to each other. It's kind of like the TCP/IP protocol. So the same way the TCP/IP protocol describes a network and the network is usually called the internet, the same way TCP/IP describes the internet network, the same way the Interledger protocol describes a network designed to transfer money called Interledger. And it works. The idea behind this is it should allow for open payments. I should be able to send money from one end of the network to the other end of the network without any restrictions. It should allow for multi-hop routing. The same way I access the internet when I actually want to get data from two networks over, the internet routes my packages from one to the next and still retrieve the data the same way without me having to worry how that routing happens. It's also designed to be a simple protocol, which we're working on it. As simple as I make it sound right here, it's actually complicated because of the different layers involved. It was designed and created by two guys who used to work together called Stefan Thomas and Evan Schwartz about 5 years ago, four or 5 years ago. And it actually maps one-on-one to the TCP/IP protocol, even though some of the design decisions in it are made to account for money, because on the internet, if I'm sending packets and I get some of them get lost or corrupted on the way, I'll drop them and re-get the packages again. In here, because we deal with money, you can't really lose money in the network. Money does never get lost in the network. So there's a few design decisions made to account for actually the packages can never be lost in this network. But they map one-on-one to TCP/IP, the application layer, the transport layer. The application layer is called SPST, and that's what you've seen in webinarization. That little string that started with a dollar, that's the addressing system. It's basically the same thing that the internet uses when you go to google.com. It's the same analogy in there. The second part is the transport protocol, and that's called stream. As the name suggests, it's a streaming protocol. So instead of having to send, the rate I'm getting money from is 36 cents an hour, right? Instead of having to send money once at the end of the session and figure out how much money I got, it's actually constantly streaming money at the rate of, I think it's 1/100 of a cent every few milliseconds. So technically, the accuracy on it is incredible because it's designed to stream money rather than send money at the end of it. The bit in the middle is what you call internet packets. In here is interledger packets. And basically, data about money bundled up into a little nice binary envelope and sent it to the network. And the BTP is the thing that connects to the actual ledger of the bank. If you think about it, a ledger is something that holds information about transactions and records. And if you think about in the world what actually a ledger is, a bank is a ledger, your Starbucks card is a ledger because it stores information and it holds money for you. So the BTP is designed to bilateral transfer protocols. It's designed to plug into one of those money networks so you could talk to them. It works kind of like banks in the sense that the SPSP or the SPSP part is the messaging bit in banks. So whenever you have to make a transfer in a bank or whenever you pay with your card, there's a setup process and it maps to that. Sending the money or the transport and the interledger layer, even some of the link layer, they have to do with clearing. So when you send money in a bank, technically don't send the money instantly. First, the transaction gets cleared. They basically figure out if you have enough money in your account, the money gets locked, and then up to 72 hours later, the money leaves your account, and that's the settlement part. The settlement part doesn't actually happen on the network, and that's one of the interesting bits. Because the money doesn't deal with settlement, the settlement part can happen outside of the network. Some of the nodes in our network settle in crypto, for example. I don't know why. Don't ask me why. That problem. Some of the nodes actually settle on the banking system. When the protocol was designed, they tested it out in their offices, and the settlement part can actually happen in cash. So they used to settle between them at the end of the month in cash. So right now, speaking about the interledger, it's designed to kind of sit in between all these little money systems and help them talk to each other. The wallet I mentioned, Uphold and GateHub, are one of these ledgers, and interledger kind of bridges the gap or connects the two together. Because as opposed to the current money system, if I try to send $1 to a bank account, most bank accounts won't accept the $1 transaction because it's so small, the fees involved are so low, the processing fees are so high, they won't accept it. If I'm trying to use Stripe to get $1 out of a card or anything like that, the fees for $1 are 37 cents, I think. 37 cents. So you'd lose 37% of that dollar. Whereas, because the intelligent network is designed to work with fractions of a cent, does not feed, the fees in the network are like 2%, so you don't lose a lot of money if you try to send on it. And it's the reason why the fact that you can send very small amounts of money into the network is the reason why web monetization as a standard uses the intelligent protocol. It makes it very easy to pay people around the world in increments of a dollar or do micropayments. If you really want to get involved with IntelliJer, with me, we have a Slack community. We meet up on a call every 2 weeks to kind of see where we're going with this. There's also a program that the foundation runs called Grant for the Web, and we're giving away $100,000 to projects who want to experiment with this technology. So if you try to experiment with web monetization, or if you try to experiment with the IntelliJer protocol, we're giving away grants for up to $100,000. The grant, I think yesterday, the new grants went out, the new application for the grants went out. There's a CFP process happening next year. Look out for that. The people who are doing web monetization, or the people who are already integrated web monetization on the website, the hangout is in this community, community.webmonetization.org. There's a lot of how-tos and examples, and a lot of people who have tried different things with web monetization. They're trying to play around with it. I highly suggest you join that. It's full of people who have kind of experimented with this tech. As I said, grantfortheweb.org, keep an eye on that. We're giving out $100,000. I think this year we're giving out close to $6 million, and next year we're giving up even a bit more than that. So keep an eye out for Grant for the Web. This was me. This was Alex. I work at the IntelliJer Foundation. If you have any questions, reach out. There's a form on intelliger.org. There's also me on Twitter. Oh, by the way, if you want to try this, if you'd like to see how it is when you pay people on the internet, not when you just receive money on the internet, I have a few coupon codes from Coil. The person that, one of the people that works with Coil, Uchi, was nice enough to give me about 100 coupon codes that are good for 6 months. So that basically means you get $50 to surf the web and kind of spread this around to other people, make people happy. If you want some of the Coil codes to try it out, reach out on Twitter. Sadly, my LinkedIn is kind of clogged. Reach out on Twitter, and I'm really happy to send you one of the codes. Și cu asta, mulțumesc frumos!
Mulțumim, Alex! Și acum, întrebările!
Am avut întrebări?
Nu! Adică, stai să vedem, da, nu cred, dar acum, din partea publicului, sigur trebuie să existe întrebări.
Ok, so I had a thing about Brave Creator Rewards, the more universal. Actually, I have Brave Creator Rewards as well. So the difference here, Brave Creator only works if you're using Brave as the browser. The web monetization standard, it works with any browser because the extension works on any browser, and you can install the extension on any browser. And the mobile is a different thing. So Brave has a mobile browser that kind of works with it. Extensions don't really work on mobile browsers, that kind of shit. There's a separate mobile browser for people who want to kind of pay the web forward, basically. It's called Puma, I think. So if for people on there, it's kind of different. The other difference is Brave Creator Rewards works in BAT, so you have to accept BAT, and that's how you get paid. I got paid in cold hard cash. I didn't do any of that crypto crap, so I get paid in pounds. And that's because the IntelliJer network used to transfer the funds from one end to the other, lets you accept anything you want in the wallet. So Uphold, I think, has 90 currencies. So I can accept anything I want, and no matter what Coil sends down the pipe towards me, down in the network towards me, in the network nodes have a conversion mechanism. So even though, I think Coil pays in dollars, so Coil sends dollars into the network, and I accept pounds, it's going to look for a node in between me and Coil that's going to do that conversion from dollars to pounds. And I get pounds in the deal, even though Coil sent me dollars. And I think that's the difference. So the Uphold KYC part, that's a different one. That's a good one. The KYC part is a property of the wallet. So depending on how how big is your wallet on KYC, you have to jump through a few hoops. For example, mine, I don't think I had to do anything that other than give them my name and address. I didn't have to upload anything. Probably they changed things. You have to sign up and see if you have to give them your driver's license or your ID or whatever. I know the other wallet, the GitHub wallet, I think for that to work, I had to send them a bank account. No, a bank statement and an ID. So I had to take a picture of my passport and send them a bank statement. And that's their form of doing KYC. If you're not familiar with KYC, it stands for Know Your Customer. And it's something that banks make you do when you transfer money from one end to the other, because they need to be able to follow the transaction along to make sure you're not sending money to terrorists or things like that. Whenever you get money through any system, you have to be able to identify yourself.
Așa, vreau o întrebare ca să pornesc discuțiile. Deci eu teoretic aș putea să trimit ție, sau există un wallet care acceptă și cripto? Aș putea să trimit ție cripto?
So that's the wallet uphold. Mm-hmm. Are și cripto în el, știi? Și cu Interledger, dacă este un nod în rețea care poate schimba între noi, poți să trimiți ce vrei tu și eu să primești ce vreau eu. Dacă sunt destule noduri în rețea, poți să trimiți cripto pe one end, dacă cineva în rețea îți acceptă payment-ul ăla și poate să-l transforme în altceva. Nu trebuie să se întâmple dintr-o singur step. De exemplu, Uphold are cel mai mult cripto în rețea. De majoritatea tranzacțiilor care involve crypto ajung la Uphold in some way and Uphold disperses it in different currencies. Și atunci diferența vine în avem în rețea crypto-ul ăla sau cineva e willing să accepte chestia aia și there's an exchange rate to whatever you want. See? Sau, dacă nu este în rețea, poți trimis pe I get whatever you send, dar eu trebuie să accept chestia aia. Adică dacă eu nu accept crypto, nu pot să-mi trimis chestia aia. See? Uh-huh.
Am înțeles.
Și nu e chiar cripto, adică înțelegi că cripto vine ca un token. Rețeaua nu trimite tokenuri, rețeaua trimite valoarea tokenului. So if you wanted to send me Bitcoin, for example, da? You don't actually send the Bitcoin, you send the value of a Bitcoin, și the value of a Bitcoin ends up with me. But you don't send the actual physical Bitcoin through the network. Pentru că it's a data network, știi? Funcționează on top of the internet and it's designed to package together value. And value can be dollars sau lei sau puimei sau value can be crypto.
Da, am înțeles. Ok, alte întrebări din partea publicului. Eu m-am lămurit.
Wait, this isn't about crypto.
Ok, this isn't about crypto. Întrebarea asta e puțin crypto. Și, deci înțeleg că protocolul este ca să transmiți valoarea over the wire. Dar există și un ledger în spate? Este un ledger de tip blockchain sau cine ține cont? Cine ce-a trimis cui?
That's it. Nu. Și confuzia vine din faptul că este ledger în nume și când zici ledger astăzi, te gândești la blockchain și la crypto, știi? Da. Nu. Ledger îi... What ledger used to be before crypto. Okay. Adică, cum mai mai zice în România? Registru contabil.
Da.
Știi? Deci aia e ledger. O bancă e un registru contabil, la fel ca Starbucks e un registru contabil. Și pentru că banii se trimit din unul într-altul, nu există nimic în between. Tu, ca ledger, ești responsabil să-ți înregistrezi tranzacția. Dar, de exemplu, uite, dacă trimit bani lui Ștefan, da? Eu trimit bani la Uphold, pentru că contul meu e pe Uphold. Uphold înregistrează tranzacția că a primit bani de la mine și face o tranzacție nouă că eu trimit bani lui Ștefan, știi?
Tot pe
Uphold. Okay. Dacă face pe GitHub, face o tranzacție că a trimis bani la GateHub, GateHub înregistrează bani ce i-a primit de la Apple, nu de la mine, și după aia îi trimite lui Ștefan, știi? Și atunci nu este niciun fel de blockchain involved în toată treaba asta. E designed to connect together ledgers, not blockchain ledgers. Și dacă te gândești la majoritatea blockchain-urilor, nu pot fi integrate, că blockchain-urile nu țin actual value on them. They hold data. Da. A blockchain address is just data. Și nu trimiți stringul ăla pe, trimiți valoarea la stringul ăla pe wire.
Deci este stateless, transfer protocol.
Da.
Acum, cei care consumă acest protocol, respectiv portofelele, ei o să țină ledgerul în ce voie, să zicem așa.
Păi, da, că design, BTP-ul ăla e design să se conecteze în your ledger, știi? De exemplu, băncile care fac chestia asta se conectează direct în their database și fac transferurile între ele at the end of the day, știi?
Ok. Cool. Mai am o întrebare referitor la metatag-ul și link-ul pe care l-aveai tu acolo. Zici că primești bani. Cine trimite banii ăștia? Există acum niște fonduri care sunt la discreție, îți faci un abonament, poate zici și n-am fost atent. Cine trimite banii?
Da. Chestia asta funcționează pe Web Monetization Provider, curent, Coil e aia. Lumea care are un subscription la Coil teoretic trimite din banii aia. E $5 pe lună, și ei îi împart la website-urile pe care le vizitezi tu. În momentul ăsta este unul singur și aia e problematic, știi? Dar we pulled them all the words și căutăm un alt Web Monetization Provider, doar pentru că în unele părți din lume chiar $5 e un pic mult și în alte părți din lume $5 nu e destul, știi? Și Coil are capabilitățile astea, Coil face one thing only. $5 și dispărție pentru tine, dar chiar povestim cu o grămadă de alte lume ca să fie Web Monetization Provider, ca să poți să ai opțiunile astea.
Ok. Și cei $5 pe care îi dai la Coil îi dai pentru a beneficia de subscription la ei și ei dau de acolo mai departe sau îi spun ăștia $5 și zic ok, noi pe toți ăștia să știți că îi împrăștiem pe tot la...
Deci tu plătești, din nou, trebuie să KYC-ul ăla te mănâncă, că dacă eu îi dau $5 la Coil și Coil împarte ăia $5, Coil face money transfer și au nevoie de un money license, ceea ce Coil nu are money license.
Ok.
De? Și atunci ei fac altceva. Tu ne plătești $5 și noi avem un pot of money și we send out of that pot of money la o rată de 36 de cenți pe oră. Dacă tu nu îți faci 36 de cenți pe oră, îi 14 ore sau ceva. That $5 lasts for 14 ore. Dacă tu se întâmplă să nu te dai pe net 14 ore pe website-uri care au meta-tag-ul ăsta, we keep the difference, știi? Okay. Dacă tu se întâmplă să te dai pe net mai mult de 14 ore pe site-uri care au chestia asta, păstrăm ultima jumătate de dolar și scădem rata aia de la 36 de cenți pe oră la 1 cent pe oră sau ceva, știi? Și atunci ei niciodată nu plătesc toți $5, cred că cel mai mult fac 4,99 sau ceva, 4,99 și change. Tot timpul dau rata aia cât mai jos ca să nu trebuiască să plătească din buzunarul lor. Știe? Și atunci pot să up to those $5. Numai că teoretic nu din aia plătesc, ei plătesc din a big part of money they have ca să evadeze KYC.
I got you. Da, și ca să fie clar, nu mă deranjează să câștige și ei ceva, știi, că sau băi.
Băi, sincer, mi se pare că ei nu tare fac bani. Ei sunt chiar foarte interesați ca lumea să facă web monetization, să adopte web monetization as a standard. Da. Ei fac bani din alte chestii. Adică Coil is a monster company that has like 50 different things up in the air, știi? Da. Faptul că lumea plătește subscription-ul, ei sunt mai interesați de tehnologia behind the interledger, pentru că when you send $5, over a month is not really interesting. When you send $5 every second, that's a different. Și ești mai interesat de chestia asta. Cred că out of the $5, they don't actually make a lot of money. Ceea ce mi se pare foarte... Na, aș vrea să facă bani că atunci ar fi mai multă competiție, știi? Dar de-aia ne uităm la un competitor că parte din Interledger Foundation they gave away a lot of money to the foundation to let us figure out how to make this ecosystem work, știi? Și atunci, no, pur și simplu și-a plătit cumva their way into having competition.
Yeah.
Ceea ce mi se pare că aș vrea să facă și ceva bani din chestia asta ca să fie mai ușor de găsit competition pentru ei. Deocamdată, din păcate, n-am numere, că îți dai seama, there's a different company, I don't actually have access to how much money they make or not. Dar gândindu-mă dintr-un perspectivă exterioară, nu știu, eu mă dau pe nemul mai mult de 13 ore pe lună, știi? Deci probabil de la mine fac un cent pe lună sau ceva, nu știu, de la restul. Restul lumii care îi plătește.
Da. Super, mersi.
Oare, și sunt curios dacă există o metodă de a vedea care sunt site-urile care au meta tag-ul respectiv. Adică de unde știu că...
Sunt poate cineva un startup să lanseze o extensie ca să citească acel meta tag.
Exact. Da, o să fie idee bună de startup, da, corect.
Băi, deci, au ei, n-au o listă, că e imposibil de a avut o listă, dar extensia când o instalezi, nu știu dacă te uita la mine, de fapt este că îți arăt să fac un link screen share. Are acolo un indicator pe butonul de extensie care îți arată dacă website-ul ăsta are sau nu are. Că ideea e să fie seamless, să nu-ți dai. E cu prima screen-oare.
Da, acum se vede.
Bun. Deci aici pe Meet, pentru că nu e monetized, n-are niciun indicator. Știi? This site isn't supported yet. Whatever. Dacă duc la mine, there's a little green dot in there that shows me I'm actually paying for this website because this website is monetized. Și ăla e the only visual indicator when you surf the web că, da, într-adevăr se întâmplă chestii.
Da, deci practic extensia citește meta tag-ul și afișează dacă e monetizat sau nu, practic. Practic acolo ai toată șmecheria. Da. Ok, alte întrebări, dacă mai sunt.
Mersi, Adrian, pentru link. Da, și chiar serios, am niște coduri de la niște căuți de la ei, dacă vreți să încercați extensia, 6 luni de subscription, nu trebuie card sau orice altă chestie să aia să start, numai coupon code și 6 luni de subscription. Nu o să aveți chestia aia ce am eu cu tip this creator $1, pentru chestia aia trebuie să sacrifici o găină și să vorbești cu cineva de la Coil ca să-ți instaleze, plus faptul că na, toată chestia asta experimentală, dolarul ăla nu pot să-l plătesc eu, știi? Deci dolarul ăla teoretic îl plătește Coil. I have an extra pot of free money to spread around the internet on behalf of Coil, cumva, știi? Dacă vreți să încercați chestia aia.
Unde e oferit suportul momentan? Pe Firefox? Pe Chrome? Unde este? Sau care e stadiul de implementare?
All modern browsers have the extension. In terms of natively baking it, nu știu să spun care o să fie primul, pentru că, adică noi vorbim cu toate acum, cu Safari, cu Chrome și cu Firefox. Toată lumea se uită la ce facem cu standardul de web monetization. Dacă ar fi să ghicesc, se spune că Firefox is going to have it first, dar, nu știu.
Nu m-aș baza că Safari o să o facă prea curând.
Băi, știi care e partea interesantă? It works really well for Apple because Apple has a wallet of their own, see? Și Apple would be a contender to be a web monetization provider. Instead of Coil, it could be Apple, see? Because they already have a digital wallet, they already have a money license. Apple is a giant. The only question is are they going to do it? I know. Think it's fast. We'll see. Înțeleg ce vorba, procesul de a ajunge de la a standard to end browser durează vreo 3 ani. Având în vedere că this is year 1, știi? Asta e sfârșitul primului an de web monetization as a standard. De-abia terminăm draft-ul acum. Aș bănui că extensia aia o să trăiască o vreme bună și că până e actually baked in a browser, undeva la sfârșitul anului viitor, poate primul browser și încă vreun an după pentru all the browsers. Procesul de a ieși din... Începe în community group, this is the web enthusiasm community group, după community group este un interest group și după interest group este a standard track, știi? Și procesul ăsta durează 2 ani, 2 ani cel puțin în fiecare, standard track poate dura 6 ani în itself. Hopefully nu, dar na, it's W3C și Melci se mișcă mai rapid. Așa de bine îmi pare că am zis chestia asta în română și nu în engleză pe recording. După cum vezi, deși eu trebuie să join the W3C, să fiu un membru, nu sunt cel mai mare fan la W3C.
Da. Acum mi-a venit o idee. Sunt curios cum s-ar aplica o treabă de genul ăsta într-o aplicație hibridă pe mobile. Deci ai web monetization, da, într-o aplicație hibridă care practic e într-un wrapper de web, știi? Și cum faci? Accesezi wallet-ul nativ al telefonului și te folosești și contribui cu fonduri din wallet-ul nativ al telefonului? Ca să plătești...
Trebuie un provider. Și atunci, na, pentru că trebuie un provider, trebuie să folosești Coil ca provider. Coil are ceva OAuth thingy. Și atunci you could, ce face extensia în browser, îi creează un, pentru că there's a lot of privacy involved here, știi? Și Coil nu știe nici cine ești tu, nici pe ce pagină ești, știi? Coil știe că tu ai voie să plătești paginile pe care te duci și tu zici, am ajuns pe pagină, vreau bani, și aia face Coil, știi? Te lasă să trimiți bani din potul lor, că ei pun toți banii la un loc și tu cumva ai acces la banii aia, la o găletuță mică din banii aia. Și atunci trebuie să replici chestia asta pe extensie, pe aplicație. Au o chestie de OAuth, au little JavaScript thingy, care face chestia asta. Deci, dar ca să dea acces la the OAuth script, trebuie să au ceva program de calificare, doar pentru că you could spend a lot of money, știi? Și atunci they have to trust you as a developer to give you access to the OAuth plug. But there's a way to do this on mobile. Și chestia asta o face și browserul de mobile, Puma browser. They actually implement this in the browser natively. În loc să folosesc o extensie sau ceva pe mobile, they use this in the browser natively. Dar folosesc tot Coil ca web installation provider.
Da, deci totul se rezumă la provider, până la urmă.
Da, adică trebuie un provider, că altfel, ca să ai raw access into Interledger, trebuie acces la un wallet, adică unul dintre wallet-uri trebuie să te lasă să tranzacționezi prin nodul lor, că e o rețea, știi? La fel ca internetul, tu teoretic te conectezi acum la internet printr-un internet service provider, știi? Care, na, în România, ISP-urile, te lasă să faci ce vrei tu în spate, ISP-urile, ai o grămadă de chestii blocate la nivel de ISP și nu te lasă să accesezi the whole of the internet, știi? La fel și cu rețeaua, trebuie să te lasă wallet-ul să accesezi restul rețelei, să trimiți banii în restul rețelei prin nodul lor, că receiving money, that everybody can do, știi? Rețeaua are de face cu trimiți bani dintr-o parte în alta, că în momentul în care vrei să trimiți bani prin rețea, trebuie să ai unul dintre noduri ca să accesezi your forwarder, cumva.
Am înțeles. Da. Dacă nu mai sunt alte întrebări, sau poate mai sunt?
Curios. Protocolul e liber de folosit. Adică eu dacă aș vrea să fac un app pe baza lui, aș putea să o fac?
Sau? Pe baza protocolului? Da, protocolul se bagă words on a piece of paper, știi? The respect that goes with the protocol, adică protocolul implementat, la fel dacă te gândești la TCP/IP, TCP/IP is a bunch of words on a piece of paper that just happen to have a lot of things that work according to TCP/IP, știi? La fel funcționează și Interledger, there's pieces of tech work based on the Interledger protocol și atunci poți face aplicația la application level care să facă chestia asta, sau dacă browserele, de exemplu, implementează trei layer-uri din protocol, implementează până la IPv4 nu implementează BTP. Depinde la care, la care dintre level-uri știi, vrei să implementezi ceva, dar se poate.
Eu, de fapt, sunt curios, există un SDK, pot să mă duc acum pe GitHub, descarc un SDK de Node și pot să încep să fac o, să implementez ceva sau, sau nu?
Nu, pentru că îți trebuie, adică este o chestie, se numește MoneyD, care e cumva the peer-to-peer version, știi, the test network. Și atunci pot să implementez chestii against the test network, dar în momentul în care you want to play with real money, sau în momentul în care you actually have to go live with real money, trebuie să get, da, money-ul ăla, trebuie să get somebody in the network to peer with you. That's usually uphold. Au un API pentru, pentru Interledger, au un API pe partea lor și they can give you access to the API și atunci, da, într-adevăr, poți face HTTP request into the Interledger network. Dar trebuie să faci chestia asta prin unul dintre noduri, GitHub sau Uphold. Ca să fii un nod, adică aplicația ta nu o să fie un nod, dacă vrei să fii un nod, trebuie money license, ceea ce nu se întâmplă așa ușor. The money license, trebuie să folosești un third party. Dacă chiar vrei să folosești chestia asta, I strongly recommend Uphold. Deși procesul ca să dea acces la API durează de 2 săptămâni, că un human has to look at you sau ceva de genul ăsta, comparativ cu the GitHub API, much, much nicer, much, much nicer. Probabil chestia asta o să, o să se schimbe la un moment dat. La un moment dat, probabil GitHub o să catch up cu el, dar decantată Uphold. Este, vine un report săptămâna viitoare, cred că, The Web Almanac, care se uită la 10 milioane de website-uri. Cred că 10 milioane am făcut anul ăsta. Ne uităm la 10 milioane de website-uri on, from Google's search thingy și câte dintre ele folosesc diverse chestii. Una dintre diversele chestii fost Web Monetization. Cred că Apple are 8-7%, da, 8-7% din, din Web Monetization goes to Apple pentru că API-ul lor e chiar mult mai drăguț decât GitHub.
Ok. Păi, mulțumim, Alex. Dacă nu mai sunt și alte întrebări, cred că ne putem opri aici. Deci, cum ziceam, în decembrie o să-l avem pe Adrian. Povestește chestii interesante. Alex, dacă ai timp în decembrie să participi și tu, ar fi super. Îi pui și tu întrebări lui acum. Îmi să pui și el întrebări. Așa. Și avem și un canal de Slack, dacă vă interesează. E cam pustiu momentan pe acolo. Eu tot încerc să-l pornesc, dar văd că lumea nu prea tinde despre el. Vă trimit. O să pun un link. Sau îmi scrieți mie și vă adaug că-i pe bază de invite. Și cred că cam atâta. Vă mulțumesc. Mulțumim, Alex. Și pe data viitoare. Mulțumim. Seară faină.
Seară faină, mulțumim.
Mulțumim, seară faină.
Mulțumim și noi.